I was born in the town of Royalton.
And what?
It's a little town outside of the city of Laporte, about 10 miles. It's a rural section. I was born on September 20th, 1923.
And what state is it?
In New York State.
Well, you know, when you were a kid, what did you do for fun, that kind of thing? What was the kind of a place was it?
Well, we lived in the country. We had a big size yard and so forth. And we kept it real nice. We always had a big garden, had lots of grass to cut. And my dad liked to keep things in A1 shape. So Everett worked real hard when he was a young boy, working around the yard, cutting the grass, doing all those various chores that are around. I spent a lot of time working around the house, I did. Take care of the yard and things. And Dad always examined things. He was real meticulous about cutting the grass. He had to cut the grass the same way all the time so that the grass always looked nice, you know. And that's before they had power mowers. You had to push the mower. But as time marched on, of course, then you got into the...
Did the Depression affect your family?
My father was a tool and die maker. He worked for General Motors in the city of Laporte. It was Harrison Radiator. And he started there when he was really young. He was only he wasn't 18 when he started. And he started in a tool room. My father was a good mechanic, he was. He worked for General Motors for 50 years. And during the Depression, my father was designated. He always worked because he worked in the tool room, see? And he was designated to keep an eye on certain people that worked there that were out of work at the time, see? To see that they got coal for the winter or if they needed groceries or whatever it may be, see? And my mother, God bless her. She had abnormal high blood pressure. She she died when she was 61 years old, is all. She died in 1964. She just dropped over. And my father, he kept working. And the Harrison Radiator, they talked him in the stand until he had 50 years, and which he did, and then he retired.
When you look back on that time, did you like your childhood?
What I done work around the house? Oh yeah, I liked what I worked. I liked the work outside. I did, Well, there was times that Dad would say, well, you better do this a little better or something of that effect, you know. But we had because we had lots of flowers and everything we did. And we had always had a big garden. We had a big vegetable garden we could feed the neighborhood, for example. But I was one that was never afraid to work. And I'd done that all through my life. When I went to high school, I went to grammar school. There was a country schoolhouse. It was only, it was just up around the corner a little bit from where we live. You walked to school, see. And I went there, and it was one of those one-room schoolhouses. I went there through sixth grade. And then I went from there, I went down to Gasport, which is a little village about, Gasport was about probably about 5-6 miles away it was. And I went there. Eighth grade, yeah. But they had a high school also. But I wanted to go to Lapore High School, which was about 12 miles into town it was. Not quite 12 miles, but they had a mechanical technical course there, which I wanted to take. So I went there. Now, I didn't have no bus to get on to go to school up there, because the bus didn't go there. Bus went to Gasport, but not to Lapport. So I rode in with my dad when he go to work in the morning. And my dad parked his car in a private parking lot right near the plant where he parked his car. So I'd ride in there, and that was right next to the high school. The parking lot was there, and the high school was right there. So I'd wait there until I could go into school, see. And then I got a part-time job after high school. I used to work in a shoe store, Brown Built Shoe Store. That was the name of the shoe store. And the man that owned it, I knew, Mr. Hilbig, his name was. So I worked there after school, and I worked there on Saturdays, see. Now, so I worked there until, I forget, the store closed like at 5 o'clock, something, I think it was something like that. Now I got to get home. My dad's got through work, he's going home. But we had a friend, a man that lived down the road from us, about a mile past our place. Mr. Francis, his name was. And he was a manager for Frojoy ice cream plant they had in town there. So Mr. Francis, he picked me up at the shoe store, and I rode home with him. So that's how I got back and forth to school in Lapport until I graduated in 1942. I went into service in 1943.
Why did you join the Army Air Corps?
Well, I never had flown before, but I leaned towards getting in the Air Corps. So when I went in, I specified that I would like to get in the Air Corps, which I ended up doing. And I went to Miami Beach, Florida. Well, first I went to, when I went in, I went to Fort Niagara. They had a induction center there where you had to go and this and there. And then I went from there to Miami Beach, Florida, to go to basic training. And we stayed right in Miami Beach. We did on Collins Avenue. I can remember that. And it was hot down there. But I took the basic there, and then I was sent to Glendale, California. Curtis Wright had a school there for aircraft mechanics, engineers, and that there, they had civilians going to school there, as well as service personnel. And that's where we came across on a train from Miami right to Los Angeles. We stopped in New Orleans, and we were able to go into town. We were a little bit and so forth. But then we stopped in the desert, like going across. They let you get out the exercise and this and that. Of course, this is when they were, the trains weren't oil, weren't diesels. They were coal fed, you know. So it was hot and dirty going all the way across the country to Los Angeles. And so we got there, and then we were taken from there out to where the school was at Curtis. Now this was in Glendale, where the Curtis Wright was. And we had the barracks we stayed in were they were fairly nice. They were, and each individual had a cubicle of their own. Your bunk in there, a little place to hang your clothes up, and this and that. And that's where I stayed until I got through the aircraft mechanic school at Glendale, at Curtis Wright. And while I was there, a fellow I graduated from high school with was there as a civilian going to school. And his name was Edward Benke. He went in the Navy afterwards, he did. But he was going to school as a civilian there while I was there at the service, which was kind of amazing it was. After I left Glendale, let's see, I went to Fresno, California.
They kept sending you to the hot places.
Well, Fresno was the, we went from there to Fresno. That was a distribution spot to where you're going to go next stop. See? So we went there, and I had to go to gunnery school, see. So I went to gunnery school out in Nevada, just out Needles Air Force. It was outside of Las Vegas. So I went to gunnery school there, and you had to be able to take a 50 millimeter or
caliber.
50 caliber machine gun apart and put it back together blindfolded, in fact, you know. So, but I done pretty well out there, and they took, I forget the how many there was. There was only a handful of us, full of us that they took, because we done well, and took us into Las Vegas, because Las Vegas was off limits. You couldn't go there, see. So we were taken in there, went to dinner and saw a show and all this and that. That's the first time I was ever to Las Vegas. Well, then I left there, and I went to Salt Lake City for a short spell. And we had some rifle training there. It wasn't there too long. And then I went to Rapid City, South Dakota, in the Black Hills. And that's where I was assigned to a crew, and that's where we done training there, see.
And you became a flight engineer, correct?
Yes, right.
And that's the guy in the top turret?
Right, top turret.
When you all got together as a crew, you got guys coming from all over the place.
Oh, yes. You didn't know who was going to be on your crew until you got there, and a crew was put together, see. Now, to be honest with you right now, it was so long ago, I've got to check into it and try and find out, but I forgot who the pilot's name was. There's more to the story, see. So we done our training there in Rapid City, South Dakota, and used to shoot at fire at ground targets as well as air targets. They'd have these tow planes that you'd throw in a target, you'd shoot at, and this and that, you know. And
do you remember what your impression was of a B-17? I mean, that must have been really something.
Well,
to see that.
The B-17 was a rugged aircraft. And it's like every big machine, so to speak, there's a certain smell to it. when you got on board, it was there, and it always stayed there, because see, you had quite a few hydraulics on your plane. Your landing gears, everything was hydraulic there. It was operated, and of course your airline elevators and that things, they were all operated by, those were by cable from the controls from the pilot. And the bomb bay, there was a narrow catwalk that went from right behind the pilot, and then that's where the turret was for the top turret. And then there was a narrow catwalk. That thing, I think, was only about 8 inches wide, because there was framework on each side of that, because your bombs were hung in there. And that went into the radio room. And then from the radio room, you went into the waist of the plane. And
what was it like in that top turret?
Well, the top turret, you could see all around on top. Now that turret, they had 250 caliber machine guns in, and it revolved 360 degrees, but the guns wouldn't fire like if you were shooting towards the tips of the wing, because they'd raise a little bit, see, when you're in the air, see. So you didn't want to hit the end of your wingtips, and also your vertical stabilizer on the tail, it would cut out, the guns wouldn't fire, see. So you could turn 360 degrees, but you couldn't fire in those dead spots, see, because you wouldn't hit the plane, see, for example. And you could raise that 180 degrees this up and down this way, and then rotate it 360 degrees.
And what would be a job description for a flight engineer? I mean, how would you describe what you did?
Well, first of all, you have to be a little mechanically inclined, let's put it that way. And because there's certain things that you try to fix if you can when you're in the air, for example. And that could be various little things, you know. Anything major, you'd have to try to get back without being fixed, see.
How would you help the pilot or co-pilot?
Well, okay, the engineer now, when you take off, that plane takes off the ground, you're standing right between the pilot and co-pilot. And you give them the airspeed that you're traveling. You keep giving them the airspeed. You get to a certain airspeed, then you lift off, see? Because they're watching the instruments and this and that, the pilot and the co-pilot, and you call the airspeed off. You do that when you're taking off. Also, when you're coming onto land, see? You do that, yeah. Mm. And of course, when you get up in the air, when you're training or when you're going on a mission, you don't get in the turret until you start to get assembled to go in across the channel. For example, we were based in England. When you get to 10,000 foot elevation, you'd put your oxygen mask on, see.
During your training period, was there anything unusual or things that stood out in your mind?
Well, when we took our training out in Rapid City, South Dakota, of course, you know, Mount Rushmore's in Black Hills. So that there was a fantastic sight to see from the air. You used to be able to fly fairly close to it, but during the time we were out there, somebody got a little trigger happy and they shot at the monument on the side of the mountains out there. And after that, you couldn't fly only so close to it, see. You were further away, see. That was too bad, because when you flew fairly close to it, you could really see the picture, and it was something to see, you know, because you could fly right at that level. Yeah. And then I had an episode one time. We used to fly at night once in a while. We used to night missions. And we came back in and we landed. And the bomb bay doors, they weren't closed quite far enough or something. I forget now. I don't remember the exact detail. But it was dark, see. Right behind the bulkhead there where the turret is, where you can walk into the bomb bay area, there's a place to put a crank in, hand crank, to crank those doors shut if you had to, see. Otherwise, they're operated hydraulically. And also, there's a spot there to put the crank in to crank up the landing gear if you have to, because that's also hydraulic. Well, I put the crank in the wrong slot. And I started to crank like I was going to crank the landing gear up, see. There's one on each side for the right gear and the left gear, so forth, like that, see. It was on the right side. All of a sudden it dawned on me, I got the crank in the wrong slot. Well, needless to say, I was a little scared. So, we got out and we had to get the ground crew out there to put a wing jack underneath the wing and jack it up so we could crank the landing gear back down where it's supposed to be. So I got called on the carpet. So the commander called me in there. I was a corporal at that time, we were training there. And he kind of read me the riot act a little bit. And I didn't know what to say at first. I said, "Well, sir, I didn't have the flashlight with me. Of course, it was dark. I didn't make any excuses. I just put the crank in the wrong hole," I says. And after I'd done it, I realized that I'm cranking the gear up instead of the door close. Well, he gave me a good talking to him, but I wasn't disciplined or anything, because I told him I didn't try to make any excuses that I'd. But that was the end of that. But I'll never forget that though, because I was a little bit scared of what I'd done, see, because I could have been. If I hadn't dawned on me what I was doing, I would have been down lower yet, see. Then I might have collapsed, for example, I don't know. But anyway, that was one of the episodes training there. Well, then, when we got through with our training there, our crew had completed our training there. We're getting ready to go to, we left for Lincoln, Nebraska. So we went to Lincoln, Nebraska, and we picked up a brand new B-17. Well, before we left, I had a Well, I said it was strep throat or something. And we weren't there, I forget, we weren't there only a short spell, a couple, 2-3 days or something like that, because we were going to jump off from there, see, to head on our way across the Wild Blue Yonder. And they wouldn't let me go. They put me in a sick bay there at the base. So my crew was scheduled to go, so they left without Everett. So that kind of upset me a little bit, because here I trained with these fellows and now they're gone and I didn't go with them, see. So they kept me, I forget now, I was only there 2-3 days or something like that, I forget all just offhand. So that was back in 1943. So they put me on another crew. The crew came along and they needed a tail gunner. The name of that, the pilot on that crew was Peterson. So they put me on that crew and we left there with a brand new B-17. They needed a tail gunner, so I was an engineer, a top turret man. But anyway, I went with them and we went to Langley Field, Virginia. We flew to Langley Field, Virginia. Well, that there is a permanent base. That's still there today. They do a lot of research down there. They got a big air tunnel and everything. That's quite a place it is. So we were there for about, I think we were there for a week, we were. They had a golf course and everything else on that base there. And while I was there, of course, now I met new fellows for my new crew, say, for example. And my good friend, Bill Pace, was a volunteer man. We got to be good friends. We still are. And so we weren't supposed to, but we jumped. We got off the base and we went to Virginia, Virginia Beach. It wasn't very far away, see. But we went up there for one day. I wonder if we didn't get nailed or something, but we didn't. We left there and we flew to Bangor, Maine. And we were there, we were only there about one day is all, and then we flew from there, we flew to Goose Bay, Labrador. And one of our transfer valves wasn't operating right when you transfer oil, fuel from the outer tanks to the inner tanks and so forth. One of those wasn't operating right, so we stopped at Iceland, Reykjavik. We stopped there, and what a barren place that was. Flat. I can see the runway. They had guns mounted alongside the runways and everything, and Reykjavik, sir. So now, with our one transfer valve not operating correctly, we had to stop at Greenland. Now we had, I think there was two of them. They were A-20s. They were a twin-engine small bomber. They were going over with us, so we'd see them periodically. But we landed it, we went to Greenland. We had to stop at Greenland. And when we pulled in there, you pull in the mountains, it's real rocks, you hardly see much vegetation whatsoever. Excuse me. And I can remember we pulled down and we would come down through there, down this forge. We made a 90-degree turn to the right, and we landed on a runway that was going inclined uphill. We were there one night is all. We stayed there. We fueled, got refueled and so forth. And we had to leave somebody in the plane because that was pretty barren spot up there. Because those fellows up there, they, different occasions, they took and took the alcohol out of the gyro in the planes. Somebody had to stay in the plane at night. Well, so anyway, so then the next day we left. Now you flew up, he'll landed up, he'll going in, you come out, you're going downhill. So we come down there, and now you've got to make a 90-degree turn to the left. Out we come. So we get out, took off. And we flew to Wales. We landed in Wales. We got into Wales, and it was, it was getting dusk time, you know. It was getting evening, early evening. We landed there, and they come out and picked us up in trucks. And they took us to a barracks, and then they gave us, we got something to eat, and I remember the food was lousy. But we got in the barracks, and some of the fellows in, there was some other planes too that had got there that they hadn't left yet. And the guys, they crawled in the sack and they jumped right out. That place was filthy with bed bugs. So our duffel bags and so forth like that. So we laid them on the floor, and we slept on those to get in the books. So the next day we left. We left the airplane there. We didn't. The plane was left there. And we got on a train. And we went on a train. I can't think of the name of the place where it was we went to now. It wasn't in Wales. It was I think we got into England. We did. We were into England then. And from there, we went there only a few days or so, and then we were assigned to the 390th Bomb Group, and then we went from there to the 390th at Framlingham. When we first got there, of course, it's a big area, and it used to be farmland before it was taken over to be an air base there. And of course, it was, when you first got there, you were assigned to the certain squadron. We were assigned to the 570th squadron. There was four squadrons, 568th, 569th, 570th. And the 571st. So at first you didn't see a lot of a base at that time, but we were taken to our squadron area, and then from there we got to see a little bit of the. Of course, bicycles were big things over there to move around the base, you know. So I don't know if. I forgot how we acquired some bicycles. Anyway, so we got the layout of where everything, where the mess hall was, and the rocker club, and the officers club, and all those kind of things like that, and where the briefing room was, and all that kind of thing, you see.
What was it like living in those Quonset huts?
Well, the Quonset huts, of course, you know, they were made of steel, corrugated steel, and they were semicircle in shape. And no windows in them. They had a door in the front and a door in the back, and one end door on the other end. And of course, your bunks were along the side, and I happened to be on an upper bunk. And we weren't there very long, only a few days, and the buzz bombs started coming over. We heard about the buzz bombs coming over from Germany. Now, they flew at low altitude, and the vibration was terrific, because I can remember in the Quonset hutch, he had a little shelf there, so you got a semi-circle shape, and you got a little shelf to go. Well, you don't have a lot of room, see? But the vibration, things that vibrate right off the shelf. Of course, we used to think, gee whiz, we don't want one of those coming down here in our bomb dump, because that wasn't, excuse me, the base was spread out, see? We got assigned to our squadron, and then I forget now how many days we were there before we start our first mission. Now, when they're going to fly a mission, your pilot's name would be posted. They're going to fly it next day, see.
And yours was Peterson.
Peterson. Also, sometimes you might not be scheduled to fly, but due to whatever the circumstances are, they're going to send more planes than they had planned on or whatever, that they might, about 3 o'clock in the morning, tap you on the shoulder and say, you're flying this morning, like that. Anyway, then they'd come in and wake you up, and the trucks would pick you up in your squadron, and they'd take you to the mess hall. So you got something to eat, and then you get back, you get through eating, they take you with the trucks, and they take you over to this big building where we're going to be interrogated. We didn't know where the mission was going to be, see. Oh, there was all, a lot of times it was always speculation, you know, but we never knew for sure until that time. And over there, in that building there, you had your electric suit that you wore to fly in. They were hung up there so they could dry out and everything and so forth until the next time. So you'd get your electric suit, you'd put that on, and then over that, when I was there, see, they didn't have the sheepskin. Earlier they had those sheepskin pants and jackets, earlier. But these ones we had were cloth, they were a greenish color, but they were lined inside, they were the jacket and the pants. But you put this electric suit on, see. Now the pants, that was a jacket, separate, and then they were snapped together. There was a connection that snapped it together, the pants and jacket. And then you had these little, they were like little felt boots. They wore silk stockings. Silk's a good for cold weather. You put those little felt boots on, and then there was also a spot there on each side to snap that together to complete the circuit to heat your those little felt boots, sir. And then when you got those, then you put your outside suit on. And then you put on your heavy, big, insulated boots, those sheepskin boots, sir. They're Oh, they were about a foot high, something like that. You put those on, slip that right on over, and zip them up. Now you got all your gear on. Now you go into the briefing room where you're going to be briefed. And an intelligence officer would brief you. Well, everybody's in there. It's going on that mission from 390th Bomb Group. It's in that briefing room. Big room. And there's a little stage there, and behind, up on that, there's a big black curtain across this room, see. So everybody's waiting, you know, till they open the curtain. So they'd open the curtain, and they'd have the route planned on where they'd just like this colored yarn, you know. They use that to show the route in and the route out, coming back, you know. And on this big map, this would be a big map of Europe or whatever, see. They'd have the little pins with red knobs on the end of them. All those little red, each one of those represent flak you're gonna get. Well, sometimes it was heavy and sometimes there wasn't too many, but anyway, that's the picture you got on the wall up there, see. And then intelligence officer would start to tell you where we're going. Sometimes, because you might not be back, you got a general idea, but you didn't maybe know the exact, that was Berlin or Cologne or whatever the name of the place you were going to go. And what the target was going to be, rail yards, bridges, or factories, or whatever. And you start earlier, it's dark when you take off, because you're. And the further you're going, the earlier you start, for example, because of distance. And it takes quite a while to assemble, see, because your bomb group assembles. You got four squadrons, so your bomb group assembles. Now you're going to assemble with some other bomb groups, see, all these planes are going to be up in the air. See now, when they all get assembled, one group is going to lead, say. But they might not all be going to the same target. See, some might be going this target, some might be going to another. So that depends on how many planes were in that group, what the target was. That governed a lot of times how many planes were going to go there. And so. You know, all this time you're circling, you're gaining altitude, you're getting, you're grouping and everything, and you're still over friendly territory, you see, then, until you start across the channel, and that don't take long to fly across there with it, and you're flying. Of course, then you're up to getting up to altitude, see, 28,000 feet, something like that.
How cold is it getting up there?
Well, I'll tell you, it gets real cold. I forgot what mission it was now, but I froze my ears, both of them, the edges of my ears got froze, frostbitten. Your helmet had your headset inside of it, see, and it. Sometimes if they're a little bit snug, you know. And so I didn't know it until we started to come down, after we started back and you started dropping down elevation and get back. And my ears started to burn. Oh boy. Well, we got back. I went to sick bay, and there I got, doctors, they put some stuff on them and wrapped them all up. And I was grounded for, I don't know, a week, 10 days, I forgot now, I just offhand, because my ears were all so sore. I couldn't wear a headset or anything anyway, see. You always went into flak, sometimes more than others, but There wasn't a lot of, but the 88 millimeter that the Germans had, I don't care what elevation you flew at, you see these black puffs of smoke. And that was an 88 millimeter. No matter what your altitude was, that stuff would be busting at your altitude. And you look out there, you see all these black puffs pop up. You're just praying to the good Lord that one of those is not going to bust right underneath you or something, you know. And I always said, if you don't know how to pray, you sure learned awful fast. A fourth mission.
Are you a tail gunner still?
I'm still a tail gunner now, yeah. Our fourth mission, we went to Cologne, Germany. And I got a piece of 88 millimeter home right now that hit me in the back. My right upper shoulder in the back. I'm a lucky boy. I'm sitting here right now. Lucky man now. So I'm in the tail. I get on the intercom and I says I got hit. So I had the you have a flak suit you put on. See, it hangs in the front and the back. Well, there's not a lot of room in the tail. You're kind of sitting in a semi crouch position there, and it kind of came through the back a little bit and went from the side, and it took the buckle off my harness on from my parachute. It took that right with it, and that ended up in me. Well, I was able to try to get out of the tail, because the tail wheel is up, see, so you got to go, there's only narrow patches to go around there, and also there's a door right there in the tail that if you had a tail gunner to bail out, you could go out that door, see. So I start, now we're up at 25,000 feet, something like that we are, see. So the waste gunner, he started to come back, and you have a portable oxygen tank that if you have to move around or something, you can plug into that, see. So I unhooked everything, and he started fishing that back. So your hose for your oxygen has got a little length to it, so I was able to maneuver up a little bit, and I unplugged and plugged into the
The walk around,
and I'm kind of a little bit delirious, and I thought I saw a big hole in the bottom of the plane, this and that, but I guess that was due to what I was shocked from getting hit. So anyway, we got up into the helped get me up into the waist of the plane, and laid there in the bottom of the plane there, and they gave me a shot of morphine because of the pain, you know. It felt like my back was swelling up, and so I'm laying in the bottom of the waist there, and we got back to the base. And of course, if you have wounded personnel on board or anything, they shoot up a red flare and they let you land first. Otherwise, you just take your turn. As far as the groups coming, your squadron coming in, see, the lead goes in and so forth. Anyway, so we got on the ground, we checked it out on a strip a little bit, and they come out with the ambulance, and they got me and took me into the little sick bay there on the base there, see. So they took me in there, and I can. they give me a, the doctor looked at me, he checked me over, and he gave me a shot. And then they transported me to a big hospital that was away from the base. So all this time I'm really aching, see, and it feels like my back is swelled up like somebody hit me with a baseball bat in the back, you know. So anyway, we get to the hospital, and took me in this operating room there. Doctor checked me over. They laid me on my stomach, see, got my hands laid on, and I can see it right now. They shoved this needle into my back of my hand in the vein there, you know, and psh, out went the lights. And afterwards, the surgeon, I come back around a little bit after they operate on me. The surgeon says to me, he says, "You're a lucky boy," he says. He says, "That could have gone right through you. You wouldn't be, you'd be gone." He gave me the piece of that 88 millimeter they took out of me, and also the brass buckle on the harness he gave it to me. He says, you'll be okay, he says, but you're a real lucky boy, he says. So I stayed there in the hospital. I forget now. I remember I had a high fever and so forth, and my hair, I thought I was going to go bald, my hair come out and everything. But so I was there, and they took good care of me and so forth. And my crew came to see me. And that's the last time I saw them. Because they went back, and got knocked down in November 30th on the Maritzburg, when we lost a lot of aircraft. Now, I didn't know this at all when I was in the hospital. So after they put me through, try to get up and get around and so forth, a certain amount of rehabilitation and this and that. And then I was taken back to our base, to my squadron. I get back there, and I find out my crew got knocked down. I didn't get any detail, too much detail, of course. My clothes are all gone. When something happened to somebody, everybody's scarfs up all your stuff, you know. So here I was, I had to get all the stuff, different clothes and things of that nature. I'm pretty down now, because my crew's gone.
Did you know if they had been killed in action or taken as PW?
Not at first. So I started to do some inquiry and so forth with our commanding officer and intelligence, trying to find out what happened. So all I could find out that they went down, and the three parachutes got out. T- the bombardier, the navigator, and of all people, the ball turret man got out of the aircraft. Well, Bill and I were pretty, the ball turret man, we were pretty close. So I used to write to Bill's mother. I had his, he lived in Waterbury, Connecticut, and I used to write to his mother and kind of fill her in a little bit what I could about Bill, see. Because he didn't get too much feedback on what took place when fellows were POWs, see. So anyway, but I wrote to her occasionally and told her what I knew. So then I got on to another, I was put on another crew. Well, I talked to the commanding officer, the squadron, and I told him my classification, I says, is to be an engineer, a flight engineer in a crew. So, you know, he double checked and he said, yes. So I flew for him as his engineer. I think I flew about three times. His name was Dick Perry. He's passed away since. Then I was assigned to another crew. Bill Myers was a pilot, so I was assigned to that crew. And that's who I finished. That's the crew I was flying with when I got my ears frostbitten. And incidentally, it was 65 below zero.
Who was the pilot you were flying with after Dick Perry? The last pilot you
flew? Well, I flew with him because your commanding officer of the squadron, he'd fly lead gypsy for your squadron periodically. And he didn't have a crew per se, see, because he was a squadron commander, but he still flew. And so he says, I want you to fly my engineer. So I think it was either two or three times I flew with him.
And who was your pilot after that?
Then I was placed on a regular crew, and the pilot was Bill Myers. Bill Myers. I don't know if Bill is alive or dead. I don't know, and I don't. I've checked, but never have seen him at or any reunion. See. So I finished up. I ended up flying 30 missions. With that crew, but I should have backtracked when I was talking about the different various missions and so forth. That's one of the things when we came back from a mission, you're always interrogated, see, by intelligence people, and you get back there, and the Red Cross was there. They gave you a cup of coffee and donut. If you want a shot of whiskey in your coffee, you could put it in there. And they want you to take it really to loosen you up a little bit, calm you down, you know. Because then your whole crew sat at a table with an intelligence officer. And he'd ask you all about the mission, how the flak was, any fighters, or this or that. And that's how they gained a lot of information as far as the flak. Sometimes they tell you there's only maybe, they might say they're going to have 50 guns with us, for example. You might get there, they might have 100. So, and they could kind of detect figure this out from how the flak was, you know, and so forth and so on. Yeah, I got a little head on towards the end of the war now. I forgot the mission now. I wrote it down, but I don't remember which one it was now. But this was towards the end of the war. We lost an engine, and so we couldn't keep up with the formation, see. So here we were, we're strays, we're sitting ducks. That's when the fighters look for us, see. Incidentally, during the time that I flew, we didn't have a lot of fighters attacked us, because they put the P-51, they put wing tanks on that later on, and they could go in farther with us, so that kind of helped the situation as far as fighters coming in. And that's the reason you fly the formation so close, so the enemy fighters can't come down through your formation, see. So here we are, and I'm up there in the top turret there, and I'm looking out towards the tail, and I can see this dark spot way in the distance. And I got a little closer, and it looked like a P-51, because they had the wing tanks on, see. All of a sudden, he's right on us. It's the ME-262, a jet engine. That's a jet plane that the Germans come out towards the end of the war. If they got that plane in the air sooner, it probably would have made an awful lot of difference in the air war, that's for sure. That plane flew right over our left wing. Well, not right over, but just off. He was so close, he didn't shoot us. That plane had 30 millimeter cannons in it. I could see the pilot's face. That's how close he was to us. I could see his face. And he was moving so fast. I cranked the turret around. I fired him, he was going too fast. So of course, right off the bat, the minute I saw him, I didn't know what it was. I get on the intercom and just intercom about the fighters. So he circled and he made another pass at us. Of course, in the meantime, we've called for fighter escort. And he came back, and this time he's shooting at us now. That 30 millimeter, the smoke from that was white. And he didn't hit us though, but he shot at us. Where we're shooting at him, but he's going so fast. Well, that's the last we saw him. That the P-51s arrived on the scene, and they chased them. Of course, they couldn't go as fast as he could, but two of them could. They tried to box them in. Well, that's the last we saw them. But I'll never forget. I could see that pilot's face in that plane when he flew. That's how close he flew to us.
Did it look odd to you to see a plane without a propeller on it?
Not really, because you know, intelligence keeps you informed on some of these different things that you might see. Now for example, another thing. So we knew this plane existed, because they'd have pictures, you know, showing you these are different planes, and they try to show you pictures of side view, front view, and so forth, so you could try to detect them easier, see. And another thing, the V-2, that the bomb that the Germans had. On one of our missions, we saw one of those. they were headed for London, see. those shot up at a certain elevation to a certain height, then they came down, headed for London, see. Those things were big, and they travel at terrific speed. You can see the vapor trail going up. We saw those ones. I don't remember exactly what mission it was, but I remember I wrote it down one time, some of my paperwork there. after I finished the missions and we got through in May 1945 after the war ended. So we were there for a little while after that, and then we came back on the Queen Elizabeth. We were taken to Liverpool, and we came back on the Queen Elizabeth, and that was quite an experience. That was
so many guys on that ship.
There was a lot of fellows on that ship. In fact, there was, if I remember right, I think it was 500 I think they were from Netherlands. Marines on there. They were bringing them over to the United States to train them. Because I'll never forget. The mess halls were down lower in the ship, you know. And you only got two meals a day. You got your breakfast, and later on you got some dinner of some type. I can see those fellas, cornflakes. Apparently they didn't know what cornflakes were. They were taking and making a sandwich with cornflakes. I'll never forget that. Making a sandwich of cornflakes, yeah. Well, anyway, that was part of the incident on a boat coming across. And of course, before we got back, the war in Japan, the Pacific, ended. We were in we got into New York. We landed, we pulled into New York, and I'm telling you, pull into that harbor and see the Statue of Liberty. It was really something. Fire boats are out there, you know, they're shooting water up in the air and all this and that, you know. And we pulled into they finally got the ship docked. And of course the ship was pretty high, you know. Everybody's wanting to get up on top where you can see and everything, you know. And see photographers up on top of these big warehouses by the dock, you know, and they're taking pictures and all this and that. Well, I'm gonna back up a minute. One of the things on the ship coming across, of course, you know, a lot of servicemen like to shoot crap. I'm not one of those, but I watch. And you see these guys up on the top deck shooting crap, you know. And while we're on the process, I think we were 6 days coming back, I think we were, before we got back. One of the fellows, man, come up missing. Crap shooter. I don't know what all the detail was, but something must have gone on, and I don't know, he fell overboard or somebody pushed him overboard or what, but anyway. I remember that about the guy shooting crap and this and that. And you know, the other thing, the food you got wasn't fantastic. And you could get Hershey bars. I used to smoke a little bit, but not very much. But I used to swap my the cigarettes for candy bars. And so that's what I'd do, is I'd swap the cigarettes to give you for the candy bars, see. So anyway, we got into New York, and then they took us from there. It was quite a sight to come down that gangplank, you know, down onto the dock and so forth, and then they put you on another boat and they took us across over to Fort Dix. So we went over to Fort Dix and we stayed there. We went there, I don't know if maybe less than a week, I guess it was. Now we got process coming back and all this and that, and we got give us a 30-day leave to go home, and a fellow that I made friends with, his name was Al Hepburn. His name was, and he lived in just outside of Poughkeepsie, New York. In fact, the little name of that little town was Hopewell Junction. So he says to me, he knew New York City, see. So he says, why don't you stop them, my folks' place here for a couple of days or so on your way where you go home, to Buffalo. So we left for Dix, and we went into Grand Central Station in New York. Of course, Al, he knew his way around a little bit. That first time I ever been in New York City. So we got on the train, and we ended up up to Al's place. His father was a manager of a big dairy farm. The man that owned it was J.C. Penny. Beautiful, up in the countryside there. And so anyway, I stayed there a couple of days. In fact, Al had a sister. She was a little redhead, she was. So we went out for dinner with Al and some of his buddies and so forth from home back there. And then I left there, got on a train, and came into Buffalo. And of course, I talked to my parents, I'd called them and so forth beforehand. Told them I was going to do and everything. And so then I got into Buffalo. And Dad and Mother were there to pick me up, you know. It was quite a day, it was. Because I left from there originally and hurried and just come, now I come back. And of course, backing up a little bit when I got when I got a hit there on that our fourth mission there, I try to write something to send to my mother and dad, you know, that before they got somebody knocking on the door, handing this news that. So you say that those email letters you could send, you know,
the email.
Email, yeah. So I was able to scribble a little bit out on one of those and got that off as soon as I could move the flipper a little bit. And they got that just before they got word from the War Department. Of course, they put it in the paper, and of course, at that time, I was a buck sergeant, yeah. But then I got to be a tech sergeant before I got through. But I got back into Buffalo, and it was so good to see hometown again. So I saw some of my friends and so forth. And I had to go to be discharged. After 30 days was up, I went to Greensboro, North Carolina. And that's where I got discharged from. I went there in in September of 1945. I got discharged. Well, of course, they tried to talk you into staying in and this and that, you know. I thought about it, and then I did, and I said, well, I wanted to go to, try to go to General Motors Institute for school after I got out. So I decided, I'm going to discharge. So I got discharged. And I got discharged on September 27th, 1945. That happens to be my wife's birthday. So I got back home and got back in the swing again. Things started to get acclimated, you know, and so forth. I inquired about, we had a Harrison Radiator General Motors plant right there in downtown. So I tried to inquire and see if I could, what the chances were to go to GMI. Because he was, like my dad had worked there a long time, see, and they try to give it a little preference to sons, so forth like that. Well, had to wait about 2 years, because fellows that were going to school there, that went in the service, had first preference to go back to go to school, which is no more than right. So I said, gee, I don't want to wait 2 years. So I says, what's the chance of getting in the tool and die apprenticeship program? Well, that sounds pretty good. So I got in a tool and die apprenticeship program. Well, first they hired me. I worked in, put me to work. I worked in the production for a short spell. And then I got started in the tool and die apprenticeship program, which is 4 years. Every day you went to school for, I forget now, it was a couple hours every day. It's a certain schooling. That was the end of the day. And they had a correspondence course that you took. But they had a teacher there that taught you, see, and everything and so forth. Certain things you had to do on your own, all this and that. That was a 4-year program, and you worked in it. You worked right in a tool room with the tool and die makers and so forth like that. They put you in there. There was a program you had to spend so much time on machines and bench and the whole deal, everything, all that stuff over the 4-year program. And then when you got to the four years in, then you were given your certificate that you were a qualified tool and die maker. So I stayed in the in the tool room for those 4 years. I went out to the West plant and I worked in a tool room out there for 3 years. But I kind of wanted to get in the engineering end of it. So I inquired on getting into the tool design, the design end of it. I'd been out in the shop and quite a bit and all this and that, see? During 7 years actually. So I got up in the tool design. And that's where I stayed until I retired in 1982. I had 36 years and when I retired. Ruth and I got married in December 7th, 1946.
How were you different when you came home?
Well, let's see. When you went in, you were green. When you came home, you were grown up. You saw a lot, some good, some bad. Because when you were flying these missions, and you saw your friends go down, you kept looking for parachutes. The thing that, by me getting hit on my fourth mission, if that hadn't happened, I wouldn't be sitting here today.